Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, depending upon where you're tuning into, tuning in from today. My name is Peter Rigge, and I'm the Global Director for the Center for Entrepreneurship and Executive Development. For those of you who may not be familiar with us, SEED is an organization to help entrepreneurs around the world grow their businesses and to help them grow as leaders. We were developed and are a part of the Small Enterprise Assistance Funds, which is an impact investment firm with over 30 years' experience investing in SMEs in over 30 countries around the world. Today, it's my great pleasure to launch our global webinar series. The Global Leaders Talk, or Leading Through Change series, will feature speakers who can talk about bright spots and solutions for short-term challenges presented by the COVID-19 virus. As all of you know, the virus has taken the world by storm and upended business and daily life in most parts of the world, and it remains a serious global threat. As of yesterday, there were 1.4 million confirmed cases around the world, and almost 400,000 of those right here in the U.S. alone. As SEED, we wanted to reach out to our entrepreneur members and beyond to help them navigate this difficult time and to share any knowledge that we or anyone in our network would have to help them navigate the challenges that are posed to business. This morning, I have the pleasure to moderate a fireside chat, or you could call it a laptop-enabled chat, with my dear friend, Jeff Hoffman. He has spoken in person at SEED events before over the years, but this is our first foray into a kind of a webinar format. And I hope the technology is forgiving. The plan is for this to be a conversation with Jeff, addressing kind of leading through the storm, then opening up the second half of the conversation in about 30 minutes into a kind of a Q&A session. Many of you have sent in questions ahead of time, and I thank you for that. But we'll also have a time to include new ones as well that come in through the Q&A function at the bottom of your screen. So if you have at any point in time, you can fill in the question, send it through. And then in probably the second half of the conversation, we'll try to get those questions answered. So, Jeff, thank you very much for being very patient. If you'll give me maybe 30 seconds more, I'll do a little bit of a kind of background for yourself, and then we can kind of begin. Jeff Hoffman is a successful entrepreneur, a co-founder that helped to build companies like Priceline. Many of you in Europe might know that by the term bookings.com. Today, he's the chairman of the Global Entrepreneurship Network, which works with entrepreneurs in over 180 countries, as well as being a founding board member of the Unreasonable Institute, which has invested and supported 165 businesses around the world. He is a motivational speaker, a best-selling author that supports the White House, the State Department, the United Nations, and similar organizations internationally on economic growth initiatives and entrepreneurship. He's also a very well-rounded person in terms of his interests. Above and beyond all that he does in the field of entrepreneurship, Jeff is also a Hollywood film producer, a producer of a Grammy-winning jazz album, and the executive producer of an Emmy Award-winning television show. So we are very privileged to have Jeff as an advisor to SEED Global. So I'd like to say, Jeff, thank you for being here, and good morning.
Thank you. It's nice to see all around the world so many familiar names. So hello to everybody. Hopefully someday when this is all over, we'll all see each other again in person. But for now, this is at least a great way for us to connect and share a little bit.
Yeah, exactly. Jeff, I thought, given the conversation, I thought we could just kind of get it going with a few kind of warm-ups here. And then if you obviously want to kind of elaborate, feel free. This is kind of our forum for you to do that. So we're probably coming into here, at least in the U.S., on our third week of self-quarantine and restricted movement. How do you see really what's happening in the world today? And since specifically for this audience, how do you see the situation as it relates to companies and SMEs?
As it relates to,
Small businesses and small businesses, SMEs.
Sure. So, this is obviously very unprecedented in a lot of ways. Different countries have experienced, different quote disasters, whatever term you want to use, from 9/11 to, wars and civil wars to all kinds of different things. But we've never had something that was global like this. And we never had something that we were all fighting a common enemy, right? So this is different in the sense that everybody on the planet is fighting the same enemy and we're all in it together. And we're all affected the same way, which is different than wars or economic recessions in certain geographies, et cetera. So this is just unprecedented. It is, and this is what we really want to focus on today. The bad news is obvious. So I want to spend more of the time talking about the opportunity, right? The bad news for small businesses is, you know, is anywhere from bad to devastating all over the world, because so many small businesses are literally just shut down right now. And you know, with quarantines and lockdowns all over the world, if your business wasn't something essential to the fight against the virus, you're just shut down. You can't go to work. You can't sell your product. You can't open your store, your restaurant. Mm-hmm. So it is very damaging to a lot of small businesses in all those obvious ways. But there's good news, because chaos always creates opportunity. And entrepreneurs, you know, live for opportunity. They live for disruption. Yeah. And disruption happens in chaos. So what we're going to see now is, and that's what I want to talk about, Peter. I want to focus on what can you do? What is the silver lining for the unfortunate, you know, tragedy of the disease and the deaths, et cetera? You know, the world is doing everything it can to attack that. But the question is, for a small business owner, an entrepreneur, what's the opportunity for you, and what should you be doing during this time? That's really what we want to focus on now.
Perfect. Maybe kind of picking up on that theme of kind of opportunity from crisis, maybe you could look at some of your own experience going through that. I know, you know, you kind of lived through, and in a business sense, the dot-com implosion at the beginning of the 21st century, and then obviously in 2007, 2008, the financial crisis. There are some parallels there in terms of, you know, being a kind of a massive crisis. It also presented opportunities for business. What is your experience maybe from those times that you think would be relevant for small businesses or medium-sized businesses?
I'll tell you what, I think that's a great question. And I'm going to jump into my three R's.
Go for it.
Three things that you should be doing. And it's because of exactly what you said. This is learnings from two places. Yeah. One, from having lived through those various things in the past, from our own experiences over many years. But it's also from, I have been spending this, my downtime, doing talks like this and communicating with small business owners and entrepreneurs literally all over the world. I mean, I love how global Seed is, because we get such a great, we get such diversity of input, right, across the Seed network that we all share with each other. Because so many of you are from different cultures and geographies and business environments. So in this process, in these last couple of weeks of talking to folks like you're on this call, and then my own experiences for when we went through economic recession and 9/11 and other things, I've come up with these tips of how we got through and what you should do. And I'm going to spend a couple of minutes, because this is probably one of the more important things. So I just call this my three R's, which are repurpose, retool, and redeploy. And I'm gonna walk through those for a minute. Perfect. Because this is what I think is really critical for small businesses now. And it's what we did. So repurpose is when you are in a moment like this, which we went through before 9/11. Remember, I was in the travel biz. Yep. And after 9/11, no one was allowed to travel. Literally every airplane in the whole country was grounded. So everyone in the travel business was shut down. So you had to sit and say, I don't know how, just like now, I don't know how long the economy, you know, the world's going to be closed. We're all going to be locked down. And therefore, I don't know how long I can go in my current business without being able to do business and sell my product. So the question is, what can I do to stay alive now?
Yeah.
And so repurpose is this process. Well, here's the task that I'd love to see everybody do. And Peter, I can share with you the poster I made of this that you guys can because I put this on kind of a small poster that lists it. So repurpose, here is the first thing you do, is you make an assessment. You sit down and you make a list. I did this on the whiteboard when I had to deal with this, Peter, back in the 9/11 especially. You make a list of all of your talents and skills and capabilities of you, of each of your people and of your company, and then your resources. That might be things like equipment or relationships. I'm gonna give you an example in a minute. And you take on the left side of the whiteboard this list of all your skills, capabilities, and resources. On the right side of the board, what I want you to do is look around at the war, we'll call it that, the war on COVID-19, and look to see what is required during this time. What are the unique new things that we have to do in the battle for COVID? And what you're going to try to do, this will be clear when I give an example, is see if you can repurpose your skills and your capabilities to address one of these problems. So here's the story that will make it clear. Yep. One of the entrepreneurs I work with, she's out in the West in the United States, but she had a small distillery, and she was producing vodka, basically, a startup, an entrepreneur. And her customers were liquor stores that she would deliver to. But when the U.S. said we went on lockdown, all these little stores and restaurants had to close. And so the people that were ordering her product, liquor stores, were no longer ordering vodka, and she was just sitting there, not able to generate revenue, and all of her people laid off, furloughed, like so many other people on this call. And so when going through the repurpose exercise, I'll tell you what she wrote. She wrote down that I employ chemists that know how to mix chemicals. We work with alcohol, and we have these big mixing tanks. That's what we do.
Sounds like sanitizer to me.
Yep, that's exactly what happened. So when she took that and said, on the right side, what does the world need? The world was having a shortage of hand sanitizer. And so she said, how do you make hand sanitizer? Well, it turns out it's chemists, chemicals, alcohol, and big tanks. Yeah. So she repurposed her little business that was not selling anything. And she repurposed it to make hand sanitizer. And now she's working round the clock. She's hiring like crazy. And she can't fill all the orders she gets. She's making way more money right now during this time than she ever made before. Now, for those of you listening, if you can't repurpose, we're going to tell you how to redeploy. So don't panic if you can't find something. That's the first step. Is can you repurpose your business? Let me give you a couple other quick examples.
Please.
Somebody else that was in a consumer electronics biz, but they did delivery. They did online ordering and they did delivery. They discovered that in where they live, so many of the restaurants that had never done takeout or delivery, and they didn't even do online ordering. It's a restaurant, you got to go to it.
Yep.
They suddenly found out that they were closed. They couldn't take customers in. And the only way to make money was to take online orders and to deliver it. But they didn't know how to do that.
Right.
And even though he was in electronics, he said, what are my assets? What are my capabilities? Well, we process orders online, even with an app, and we have a delivery fleet. We have delivery vehicles. So what he did was he repurposed his whole group. He contacted all the restaurants geographically around him, and he offered to adapt his online ordering platform to take orders for them. And then he used his delivery vehicles and said, we'll deliver food for you guys. So all his employees are busy. Everybody's getting paid again, but they repurposed their whole team into a food delivery business. So repurposing is looking to see what problem you can solve now that people need solved with the skills you have. Go ahead, Peter.
No, that's, as I say, that's a fantastic example of repurposing. Could you, continue and give us an example on the retooling? Because I think you made an interesting point.
Yeah, so we got retool and redeploy. So retooling is something that is an opportunity that you should think about. I'm hearing from so many people and so many employees, whether they're entrepreneurs or the employees of startups and small businesses, they're home now. And unlike working for some businesses that have, they're giving you work at home, a lot of them are doing nothing. They literally don't have much work to do. Again, if you're in a restaurant, it's closed. There's nothing really to do at home, per se. So a lot of businesses, software developers that I talk to in the IoT and IT business, and their customers put their projects on hold. And so they don't have something to build right now. Anyway, while you're sitting at home, here is a question. This is the retooling piece for you to ask yourself as a company and as an individual, which is, what are the skills and capabilities that I really would love to have that I've never had time to acquire? I'm going to give you an example in a minute. Okay? Because now you're sitting at home. There's some skill that you've always looked at. Let me give you the company example. The company example would be you and your small business have read about artificial intelligence. You've read about augmented reality, AR. You've read about virtual reality, VR. You've read about facial recognition technology. But you don't have time for those things. You're running a business. Yep. Now that you have time, retooling is saying to yourself, what new capabilities could we add to our business during this downtime while my employees have time to learn so that when we come out on the other side, we're a stronger company? So here's the example. This was a consumer products company that sells their products to consumers in retail stores, which are closed now. So they're not selling anything now. So when we had this conversation, one of the things I was asking, what do you wish you could do? And he said these words. He said, predictive behavior for my consumer markets. I wish I could do predictive behavior analysis. And I said, why can't you? He said, because that's this, like, takes like artificial intelligence technology that we don't know, we don't have. Yeah. So here's what he's doing. He is retooling his workforce. All of his marketing team and his salespeople and some of his IT people are taking free, they're getting AI certificates.
Excellent.
They're taking free online artificial intelligence courses. They're getting certificates in AI. And when I talked to him Friday, they're designing a predictive behavior algorithm in their company now that all his team is learning AI. So when they come out, their marketing's going to be way better than it ever was. So my question is, what certificates would you like to get? What education would you like to get? What skills would you like to develop for your team or yourself that you never had time to develop? What they're doing is he's asking his employees for like 2 hours every day to take an online certificate course. And when he's on the other side of this, retooling-wise, their team is going to be way smarter, way stronger, and have way more capabilities than they did before this pandemic. So, Peter, that one's 2 of 3. That's retooling.
That's great.
And I suggest everybody go learn something new.
I think, Jeff, another point on the retooling, too, is beyond just the economic side of it, and you mentioned the predictive behavior example, it's also a way of just the employee engagement. You know, when they're in this downtime, when they're in this kind of uncertainty of what's coming next, you're finding a way to not only get that new skill, but focus them and keep them really engaged so that team is ready to come out on the other side versus maybe, you know, dissipating if they didn't have a way to focus themselves. So just another point.
That is, in fact, Peter, that's the perfect segue to redeploy because employee engagement is part of this. So redeploy, the third R is, sorry,
myself
water. Redeploy is if you look and you can't, everybody can retool. There's something you can learn, but not everybody can repurpose. Your skills may not be transferable to some problem today, like the companies that were in, you know, plastics and now they're making masks. Not everybody can do that.
Right.
So if you cannot repurpose, here's what redeploy is about. In the repurpose exercise, on the left chart, you made a list of all your company's skills and capabilities. Now what you should do is look at all the companies that are solving COVID problems where you live in your geography and see what kind of assistance they might need. I'm going to give you an example again. So there are a lot of nonprofits, charities that are feeding people, that are providing medical care. Thank you. There are a lot of companies, well, let me just go straight to an example. So redeploy is saying, can your employees be sent out to help other people that need help since you don't have something for them to do? So I'm going to give you a great example. I was talking to, this was a software company. They were software developers. And they were shut down, like I mentioned, about the other software company and unsure what to do. So we made a list of, we did the repurpose exercise. What are your skills and capabilities? Well, it turns out that they have SEO people and SEM people that are really good at internet. They have online marketing people that know how to do online marketing. And they have graphic designers that create content for online. Yep. So none of those people had work right now, and they were kind of furloughed. Yep. But I asked him to research his community and see who are the players in your community that are on the front lines of the battle against COVID. And he saw a story about a local hospital. It was a medical center. And the head of this hospital in his city was on TV saying, people are following so much bad information. There's so much misinformation about COVID, how you get it, how it spreads, what the treatment is, what's safe to do, what's not. And so he said, we want to put out information from the hospital because people trust us. However, we're doctors. We're not online marketers. So the software company redeployed his graphic designers and his online marketing team. He loaned them to the hospital. They created a COVID awareness campaign for the hospital in their city that is phenomenal. Then let me tell you something else in redeploy. So the question is, who can you loan your people to? By the way, one of the people that had vehicles, because they used to deliver their product, in addition to, you know, they discovered that there were a lot of schools that used to feed kids that were economically disadvantaged, and their only meal they used to get was their school lunch, and now they have nothing. So his team is out, he's redeployed his team, and they're delivering food to these neighborhoods. Several of the restaurants have said, while we want to sell takeout meals, we also want to serve for every meal you buy. We're going to deliver a meal to someone who can't afford a meal right now. So redeploying is loaning your skills and resources to the people that need it most in your community. And in some cases, there's two benefits. In the case of that medical center, the medical center got a grant from the government to fight COVID. So they wound up hiring all his graphic designers and online marketing team. They said, hey, we can pay you guys till the crisis is over because you're doing work. So you may be able to redeploy, loan your employees to a first responder or someone on the front lines who may pay them. Now a bunch of these restaurants are willing to pay these delivery people that my friend had, and he originally offered to just help out. So he feeds the people who can't afford food, they deliver for free. But for the rest of the market, they get paid for it, and his employees are working again. One last thing about redeploy that Peter mentioned is really important. It is an unbelievably valuable employee engagement tool. And the reason is, and your team and yourself, your team is sitting at home. They're worried. They're stressed. They're uncertain. They're waiting. The clock is ticking slowly. They suddenly have become homeschooling teachers, even though they have no education in teaching kids. And everybody's stressed out. Sitting around stressing and worrying and wondering is really takes a toll on people. But when you're at least doing something, when you're out delivering meals, helping a hospital, whatever it is, when you're part of the solution, your attitude is so much better. You don't feel helpless anymore. When you get home, you say to your kids, even if it's only 2 hours a day, hey, I'm out there feeding people. I'm out there helping the hospital. Our company, our employees are out there on the front lines doing something somehow. It doesn't have to be literally in the front lines. You might be doing it from your living room, developing web pages for the hospital, like I said. But the point is, being engaged in solving the problem is way more emotionally fulfilling and makes you feel way less helpless than just sitting around waiting. So those are the three tools you should try: repurpose, retool, and redeploy. And Bree, I'll send you the document that defines these in more detail that you can share on the Seed website for people that want to get it.
That's great, Jeff. That's fantastic. I think you're getting at the business side, and you're getting really at the human side of what it means to kind of get through some of these this crisis. I would ask if we can kind of switch gears a little bit for this audience in terms of some of the things that companies can do directly. In addition, obviously, the repurposing, retooling, and redeploying are critical pieces of that. But even in terms of how they go about their current business right now in this kind of waiting state of mind. So one of the things we've really pushed a lot at Seed is that for companies to continue to really be proactive, whether it be with their supply base, whether it be with their lenders, to kind of get out in front and to be very proactive about either whether it's restructuring or some of the terms that they need to have with their bank lenders. Also, even in this time where each government is quite different in terms of the response, but there are different government programs and things that are happening. So the way to get out in front of that is sometimes in terms of just looking at even your personal networks and contacts to make sure that you're really highly aware of those programs and whether they apply to you or not. And then another key one is really bonding with other companies, whether they are competitors or not, is to learning how to cooperate sometimes with your industry peers in terms of either lobbying or making your situation known to some of the decision makers within your society, whether they be banks or regulators or others, so that you're not one voice by yourself, but maybe a voice with others to kind of advocate for your position. So those are kind of some of the tips that within the seed world that we've been trying to get out to our members that they then have to localize. But I had just wanted to kind of get your comments on maybe some of the what you're seeing in terms of certain industries. Like as you talked about the three R's, you brought up very specific industries in terms of how they're responding to the COVID-19 crisis and seeing that opportunity in it. Maybe you could give maybe some other examples or look at some other industries where you're seeing opportunity as well, whether it's in sure. other types of tech or that would be great.
So before we do the industries, let's do the tips that are not industry dependent. And then we'll okay. talk about specific industries because you hit on a really important one, which is forming local community, but forming new ones. Yep. So one of the things that I'm seeing people do that I absolutely love that I recommend is what doesn't matter what industry in, let's say you're an IT company, whatever, and geographically, locally, reaching out to all the other small business owners in your community and forming a brand new Zoom group, right? And people that aren't, you've never talked to them because either they're competitors or because they're in a completely non-related industry and you don't cross paths. But now is the time we're all in this together and we need to share survival tips, as Peter said. So creating a small group, you know, whatever, an entrepreneurial CEO's working group. You just reach out, research and find, whether it's on LinkedIn or whatever it is, find all the other small business owners in your community and create a new group and say, we're going to talk every Friday. And every Friday, we're going to have an open Zoom and we're going to share, what did you do today? What did you, for example, who successfully got a 90-day extension on their rent from their landlord and how did you pull that off and what did you say? Who found a new government program we need to know about? Who found a great way to renegotiate terms with suppliers so you don't lose the contract while you're not paying on it? Things like that. So form your own little small business working groups in your community. Obviously, organizations like Seed, and the reason that I'm in part Seed for many, many years is because this is a great source of sharing information across countries. So, you know, we'll do the global piece here and provide you everything we learn. But locally, each of you should form your own local working group and you should be talking like once a week and sharing. And by the way, you know, that shouldn't just be for business. You should have a parents homeschooling Facebook group or Zoom group that's just in your neighborhood, just in your city. Because going on to a big national or international one, they don't understand your culture. They don't live in your country. They don't know what it's like. So forming a local neighborhood, parents who can't teach would be the name of your group. Yeah. And you would be sharing tips on how are you getting your kids through this. And so do this on a human level, form new groups, new community, and do this on a company level. Now, what are two other tips? Peter hit obviously two really important ones that I won't repeat, which is you know, making sure that you are researching every form of government subsidy, any help you can get from your government for a small business financially this time, and reaching out to all of your accounts payable, whether it's your landlord, your utilities, everybody that you have bills you have to pay to. This is the time to reach out and say, we're kind of shut down, we can't pay that bill, can you give us a program? Don't just sit there and stress that you can't pay it, call them. Most of the world is now willing to say, we get it, we're in the same boat, give us a payment plan, you know, let's project when you can pay. Talk to your payables. Talk to all of your suppliers, everybody that you, your utilities that you owe money to, as Peter mentioned. But here's another piece that all of you can do during this time. We all talk about the importance of relationships, customer relationships, but we don't really have the time we wish we had to build them. So here is a perfect time for you during this downtime to strengthen your relationships with your customers when they're not even buying anything. And you do that by sending, reaching out to people, whether it's email, text, telephone, if you can do that, whatever it is, sending a note to all of your customers saying, in these difficult times, we just want to check on you and your family. How are you doing as humans, as people? We're not trying to sell you anything right now. We just want to make sure you're okay. And by the way, if you're not, feel free to call us here at the company. Maybe we can help. Tell us how your family is doing. Tell us how you're doing. Tell us what you're feeling. Reach out to your customers and show them your heart. Show them, just ask them how they're doing. Show them, they will remember this afterwards. And by the way, if you are redeploying and if you have loaned your graphic designers to the local hospital, you should say, we just want you to know that while we can't service you with our typical products, we're not just sitting here. We've loaned half of our workforce to the hospital down the street. We're trying to help. When this is all over, customers will remember your heart, not just your product. They will remember that you checked on their family. They will remember that you're the vendor, you're the supplier that loaned their people to a hospital when the other people didn't. All those things will add up. So strengthen your relationships with your customers now. So those are our tips that apply to everyone. And Peter, now I was going to hit some specific industries.
Can I interject just for a second before we hit the industries? A couple of things. One, just as a reminder for any of you who are just joining this webinar, that there is a Q&A function in your toolbar at the bottom where you can send through questions that will then be, for the second half of this talk, be sent through so we can try to get as many of those answered as possible by Jeff. You can also share your thoughts and reactions. I also just wanted to make a comment as you talked about in terms of the importance of these kinds of groups, whether it's Zoom, this today would be Zoom groups. Within Seed, one of the things we have worked on a lot is really developing peer group methodology, how to bring people from the diverse industries together that have some of the same challenges in terms of the growth of their companies. And typically that was done in person. But we ourselves, we're a company as well. We've had to kind of put everything online in the last 2.5 weeks and move all of our peer groups and things there. And I think you really brought up an important point that there's a certain amount of support that people look for from in a professional sense, right? In terms of just how to navigate, what tips, what are other people doing, especially in my local environment, because that's really relevant as well as the global trends. But I think it's also that other one around the personal support. Just how are you doing? How are you getting through it? Giving people a place to kind of let that out a bit among other people who truly understand the pressures that they are dealing with, whether it's meeting payroll, whether it's meeting rent. I appreciate the little plug there for Seed on that level. And so now maybe we can jump to your examples.
Okay, so let's talk about specific industries because they're all being affected in different ways. But again, there's some good news here. Because there are going to be new business opportunities that didn't exist before. So let's talk about that. The industries that you know, there's no way around the bad news that are going to be hit, for example, is travel. you know, I get asked this when I go on television, is travel ever going to come back to the level it was? And I think it's not. And I think it's not because all of these companies in the world that have never done work from home, Peter, I got such a kick out of seeing people text each other. Somebody texts, WYD, what you doing? The other person texts back, WFH. And in the past, if you texted someone WFH, they would have replied to you with a WTF question mark.
Exactly.
Because no one knows what WFH is. Right. WFH means just working from home. But that didn't even exist just a month ago. And now everybody knows the term WFH. Everybody's working from home. So with all these companies learning how to work virtually and learning how to work at home, when all this is over, a lot of companies are going to say, hey, those tools are really effective. I don't think if I use Zoom and I use Slack and I use all these tools, I don't think I need to have all my employees in the office every day, every hour.
Exactly.
And traveling, people are going to say, I don't really need to fly to my regional office. We can do this on Zoom now. They've never used Zoom before this crisis. So travel numbers, I don't think are ever going to get back to the same because people are going to discover that virtual working works. And so that's an industry as an example that's just never going to recover fully. On the flip side, though, there are industries that are going to explode that you should be looking at and seeing if you can serve into them or either indirectly or directly. So let's talk about three. Mm-hmm. One of those industries we just talked about, which is online work. Virtual work is an industry that there weren't very many tools. You guys wouldn't believe how many competitors to Zoom are going to be launched in the next like 10 days. Huge, you know, huge numbers of people saying that there's only a small number of solutions for working at home. And there's, you know, we're all learning what we like and what we don't like with the current tools and what we wish we had. So the work at home environment, if any of you listening, if you have ideas how to make virtual work better and easier, you have a business opportunity. We saw that, you know, Zoom, as an example, their stock took off when all this started because the investor community said, wow, the people that help you work at home are going to have massive business globally now. And that's an interesting thing. It's global. Your market might have been a little more cultural or geographical. Some countries would never think of working at home in the past and you couldn't sell there. But the whole world is quarantined, right? And so you're going to have a market opportunity all over the planet if you have work from home tools. Two other industries that are really being impacted. Online education in general.
Yeah.
So many schools in the world were not prepared at all to send their students home. I've talked to so many people in the education business that said our school did not have an online learning tool. And we didn't have the technology or training. We don't have training for our teachers. And we don't have technology to manage coursework and classes online. So everybody getting into the online education business will have a huge global market that's suddenly going to explode. And even, you know, people are saying, well, they don't want to ever get caught off guard again if anything else happens. So even if they go back to school, that's not going to slow down the growth of online education. That will bleed over into the events market like we're doing right now. All the people that used to do, that I've been talking to, that used to be in the conventions, meetings, and you know, live events business, they're all the way down to music and concerts. Everybody's looking to say, how do we get into the virtual events business? Because we've never been in, we don't really know how to put one on, and we need more help and more tools. So part of online education. And the last industry I would say that's going to be huge is telemedicine. And when you can't go to a doctor, so many doctors, I have my own doctor on that I talked to last week. I was talking to my doctor last week, and my doctor said, I just did the first Zoom call of my entire life, the first Zoom appointment. Said, I've never done a virtual appointment where we traded medical records. I could physically see the person, et cetera, and see how they were doing. So online medicine, telemedicine, access to doctors, electronic swapping of patient records, and that goes all the way down to preventative care at home. What things do you drive to a doctor or a medical center for now that new technology will let you do at home? For example, I saw something where if you a heart patient and you once a month do an EKG, I saw an app that you plug these cables into your phone, your smartphone, and it shows you where to stick them on your chest. And then it reads it and it sends the results right to your doctor. So you don't even drive to the medical center for an EKG anymore. You can stay in your home and get your heart, your scan done. So telemedicine, Peter, is another industry that's completely retooling. Online work, online education, and online health are massive opportunities.
Great. Those are fantastic examples, Jeff. I really appreciate the specificity. At this point in time, just given where we are, it's about 9:38. I'm taking some questions that are coming in from around the world. So they're not in any particular order. I'm just going to kind of fire a few through, and you could just give us your best reactions to them. The first one here just comes in from Slovenia, and it talks about really looking at the real estate market. You're saying, how will this crisis affect the real estate market, including things like renting and not just owning? Do you think there will be a change?
Yeah, real estate's a good one. I've been talking to a lot of people in that space as well. We are going to see a change, commercial and residential. In the commercial space, I think we're going to see a reduction in long-term rent, long-term leases for everybody works 5 days a week. All 100% of our employees are in the office. People are going to discover the power of teleworking tools, and they're going to say, you know what, you could work. An example is the company I mentioned before, the company that said to me, after this, we're going to go to 2 days in the office and 3 days at home. It's more human for our employees. They're proving to me during this pandemic that they can get their work done at home. They just do it on their hours, you know, around their family if they have one. And so they're saying, we're not going to need an office full time anymore. We're going to have more remote workers. So that being said, you're going to have a decrease in, you know, in the long-term lease in the commercial market, but I think you're going to have an increase in pop-up offices. It's not just co-working space, right, what we think of for entrepreneurs, but it's actual, executive offices, I forget the term, it's different in every industry, but it's an office that you basically use by the hour or by the day. Yep. When you need them, when you need office space because you have a meeting with a customer that you need to meet in person, but you don't need to go to the office of the city it's in, but you need an office to meet with a customer in. So you'll see more of these rental office spaces in the commercial space. And you may just need actually to get out of the house away from the kids for 2 hours to finish an assignment. And you need an office to do that. So I think we'll see some of these commercial spaces converted into more of these pop-up office spaces. In the residential side, I think you're probably also going to see, you know, in the short term, it's obvious. It's really hard to sell a house right now when people are not allowed to leave. And, you know, when people are supposed to be staying at home, they're not out looking at houses. And when there's economic uncertainty and financial uncertainty, people are putting off that big purchase, the house being your biggest life purchase. So selling, you know, the residential sales market, it's a buyer's market right now. The flip side of that is if you're in the real estate investment space and you have some cash and liquidity, I know a lot of real estate investors who are saying now's the time to buy homes at the bottom of the market, right? And when the economy recovers, I can acquire a lot of inventory in the market, investment homes during this time. But I think we're going to see an increase in the rentals in the residential space, because when people find out that they don't necessarily have to live right near their office and they can live where they want, it's going to be a more mobile society. And if I can do more work at home and remotely, then I can be wherever I want to be. The office doesn't matter if I'm a remote worker. And so those people are not going to want to be tied into, not all of them, but I'm saying some percentage of them, won't want to be tied into a house forever. They'll want rent. They'll want to rent for a year or two here and there, then move another city they've always wanted to live in. So I think those are the changes we're going to see in the real estate market.
That's great. It was really, really thorough. Again, a lot of questions coming in, so I'm going to do my best to try to get through these. We had a question that came to us from the United Kingdom that talked about getting new customers. So you had mentioned, for example, in your example under redeploying, that the company that had lent out its some of its design and other services to a hospital that then ended up leading to a new client at some point, or it should. Are there other ways that customers or businesses that are kind of at home that can reach out to their current customer base? How can they reach out to new customer bases? Or do you have any tips on how they can reach out to new customers that they're currently are not part of their network?
Well, I will tell you the most effective way. Again, I'm going to be real here, even though this isn't, you're not going to want to hear this.
Yeah.
If your product is a non-core product during a time like this, and you're reaching out to a new customer and saying, "I'd love to show you my product," that isn't well received right now.
Right.
They're like, "Seriously, because I'm stuck here with the family. I lost my job. I'm very stressed, and you want to sell me something that I don't even need right now." Introducing a new customer to a product that they don't really need right now is not well received generally. So here's the way that you do that. the way that you do that is through the redeploy. The efforts that you're making in the community, the things that you're doing, and if you're not doing any, then somebody that is going to have a better shot at those new customers.
Right.
Is for you to reach out and say, "Hey, I know you don't know us. We've never done business with you before, but we are a company. We live in your community. We're neighbors. We just wanted you to know that we've been delivering meals for the schools in the area. And, you know, if there's anything, ideas you have, anything you need, make sure you reach out to us," knowing that they're not a school and they probably won't reach out. It's an awareness campaign,
yep.
Right? But the lead to the awareness campaign is your social good. We are a company in your neighborhood. You're not a customer of ours. That's not why we're reaching out. We just want to tell you, let you know that we care about this community and we're helping schools feed kids while the school is out or whatever it is. We're helping the hospital with their online information campaign because we love this community. And we just wanted to say a neighborly hello and hope you're doing well. And if we can ever help, let us know. Don't sell something.
Right.
Except introduce yourself as a neighbor. Show them you care about this neighborhood. They will remember that. And they will look and say, "I don't even know who this company is." And they'll probably click on it. and say, oh, I didn't realize that, you know, I already have a product, but this company seems cool, right? When my contract ends, I might want to look at this company. They will make a note of you. So that's a way to reach out, but I do not advise just reaching out with a straight kind of, we want to tell you about our product, because people are not in that mood right now.
It reminds me, Jeff, you told me many years ago, the first step is be of service. If you can be of service, be of helpful, and then you can move toward more of the sales side. Again, I have another question here that's a little more industry specific, so I thought I would ask you to comment on it. This comes to us from Kosovo, and they're asking, what will happen globally when you are looking at the transport and kind of logistics industry as a result of the kind of COVID-19 crisis? Do you see any major changes in that space?
Yeah, I actually see a huge opportunity. Because the other thing that's happening is that all kinds of companies, from restaurants to grocery stores to you name it, all kinds to toilet paper, all kinds of companies who never delivered their product are trying to figure out how to be in the delivery business. Think about restaurants as the easiest one. So many restaurants that never had delivery. And in some geographies, you're going to say, well, there's Uber Eats or DoorDash or whatever. Some places, people are telling me that they're forecasting 2-hour wait to get your food, 2.5 hour. Because these companies, the market is now way bigger than a few vendors. So don't worry that there's already someone in your market that you can order food from a company like Uber Eats. They cannot possibly handle the demand. And they're seen more as a big global giant and not a local company who cares about the neighborhood and, per our example, helped our neighborhood out when they needed it, right? So logistics and you know, everything in the logistics and delivery and fulfillment biz, you're going to have all kinds of people that are trying to deliver their product that never did before. And after this, they didn't have takeout. They didn't have delivery of their product before the pandemic. During the pandemic, they had to figure out how to deliver. So afterwards, let's stick with the restaurant example. Sure. Restaurant that you used to say, hey, you want to go to that Chinese place? And someone would say, I'm really tired. I don't feel like getting dressed and driving to the restaurant, because that was your only option. Now you're going to say, hey, now they have delivery. So the number of people that want logistics on the consumer side, they want fulfillment. Deliver me something. And we need more companies in that business. On the retail side, they don't know how to do logistics. That restaurant is going to discover that their driver made an incredibly stupid route, right? He just put an address in his GPS and he didn't know what order. He's not a logistics person. So as they get more into the delivery business, they will want a logistics company or logistics software, route planning, all kinds of tools to help them be efficient at logistics. Big opportunity.
Excellent. That's a great answer. Here's a question that comes to us. It's a bit more on the macro level from Tunisia. And, you know, there are certain governments that are responding quickly to this crisis, other ones that maybe not with quite the same speed. And to an entrepreneur, that can be a little frustrating at times. The question here is a little bit bigger. It's looking at in terms of what will potentially come. You know, is it true that we are at a risk of an unprecedented global insolvency crisis? And does Bitcoin or other online currencies represent a solution to that?
Okay, so it seems like I have to say this once a day. I have this crazy sort of, I don't know, philosophy, that standard that I stick to, which is that if I don't know the answer to a question, I don't answer it.
Fair enough.
And Peter, I say that because you and I have been at conferences all over the world.
Yep.
Where someone asks a question and you hear the speaker answer it and you're like, what? That's not even right. And the speakers often feel like, well, I'm supposed to be the smart person, the expert, so I'll answer the question. If I don't know, I don't answer. I don't know the Bitcoin market, so I'm not going to just guess or make something up. Unfortunately, I'm not the one to ask. In terms of insolvency in general, again, I'm also not an economist, but I am worried when you get, well, the U.S. example is a $2 trillion package. Yep. So there's this one little question, where did the $2 trillion come from? But that's going to be the question for major economies everywhere. You know, in the UK announced a package, a stimulus package before the US did. In a lot of economies, governments are stepping up as industries are going down. The global airline industry, it's like $355 billion in revenue that they lost that they would normally get, just as another example. So, you know, already insolvency is happening. Airlines are down 80 to 90% and they're insolvent in a short period of time. And the question is, which businesses will die and which businesses will get bailed out, from small businesses to big ones, by their governments? And where will the governments come up with the money? So I think because everybody's acting in emergency state and making decisions quickly, by definition, these decisions have not been thought through all the way down. And we just don't know how deep the dent in the economy is going to be. My answer to you, unfortunately, is I don't know either, but I'm worried about it.
Yeah. No, I think that's probably a similar sentiment that all of us have. And unfortunately, none of us really know the complete answer to that.
Not yet.
As I kind of scroll through the different ones here, some of them are a little redundant, but that's okay. I think it's still important to get things out. Here's one that's, I think, a bit more general, rather than just being a COVID-19 situation. But maybe you could provide a little bit of advice or feedback. This is, again, an entrepreneur from Tunisia, and is more in the kind of IT and engineering space, and is dealing with a little bit of what I would call a brain drain issue, where the company has done pretty well, at least up until the crisis, and hopefully doing well still. But they're having a real problem keeping some of those engineers, just because when they're skilled, they tend to go to the more developed markets in Europe. It's hard to be competitive when it comes to salary. Do you see any solutions out there? This is, like I said, more of a general question, to kind of keeping some of that talent on board.
Yeah, that's the big question all of us have as small businesses, retaining talent, because, you know what, here's your decision you have to make. If you only have, well, just for this example, if you only have $1,000 to spend on talent, just to make this a simple example,
yep.
Your choice, and you have 10 employees, your choices are, you can, you know, pay everybody $100 and give all your employees something, right? Or you could keep two employees for $500 each and let everybody else go. It's a really hard decision. Yeah. And so these are hard times. So one of the questions that you need to ask yourself, this is another exercise I recommend doing. It's painful, but it's important, is to make a list of your team, everybody you have on payroll, and then rank them in value from one, if you have 10, from one to 10. And what your ranking is, basically, it's a combination of the value of their contribution, but it's also the difficulty in replacing them. This is just real. You just have to do this. So how long have they been with you? What are their relationships with your existing customers? You know, how well do they already know your company, your products, your systems? How unique is their skill set? So you're rating the value of your people first, because when you do have to start making decisions, one of the ones you should make is, I probably need to hold on to the people are easier. Nothing's easy. Which people are easier to replace after the crisis if I let them go and they never come back? And which people am I going to wish I never let go? I'm going to wish I struggled to retain, and decide how to use your money that way. So I don't think you should automatically say, I'm going to give $100 to all 10 people and keep everybody, even though I understand that there's the human part of this decision. Mm-hmm. What I'm telling you is, if you let somebody go and you want to give them $100 personally because you care about their family, do that. But as a business, you're going to have to make hard decisions. And as a business, you should be trying to retain and help the people that you know in your heart would be impossible to replace if they didn't come back if I let them go. And so that's the hard decision we all have to make right now. But that's what I want you to look at. People that you say, this wouldn't be too hard to find someone else to do this job, then you shouldn't be spending a lot of money on them. The other question people keep asking is, how, you know, if my business is slowly slipping away from me and I do have some cash reserves or personal money, how much do I keep putting into it alive at this time? And that's a very individual decision, based on your cash reserves and the operating costs of your business.
Wow, that's great. Jeff, this is one, again, it's a kind of a general one, because we have several seed members who are in this industry around the world, but it's more looking at the industry on the impact on the insurance business. You know, the question says that they're basically engaging their sales force, trying to find different ways to sell their policies, and that it's quite difficult at this point. Do you have any thoughts on the impact of the COVID-19 on the insurance business?
Well, you know, I think unfortunately that falls in the bucket we talked about before as something that people aren't focused on right now. Their cash is tight, they're holding it, and right now, food, right?
Yeah.
And keeping the lights on and making sure they don't get evicted because they didn't pay their rent or their mortgage. People are making a similar list in order of the things they have to pay first, 1 through 10 of all the bills they owe. And then they start at number one. And once that paid, if there's any money left over, they make a payment on two. So unfortunately, the bad news is people are telling me things like that. They just can't deal with it right now. However, for the insurance industry, here's something I heard the other day from someone who was a big player in it. The question came up, will there be future insurance products that don't exist today that are designed around helping me through times like this? I don't know the answer, but if I was in the insurance business, I would be doing all the research I can to be one of the first people to offer some kind of new type of business or personal insurance that protects or helps people during times like this, if this ever happens again. Because there's people that are going to say, how do I prepare or defend and protect myself, my family, and my business from anything like this ever happening again because I was caught so off guard? If the your insurance industry creates some new products to help protect people, you should know about those and be on the front of that pack.
Those are great points. I mean, you're talking about basically a new Aflac equivalent for,
yes,
for crises. Yeah,
that's a good example.
And I also saw that Allstate and a few other of the big insurers in the United States, in terms of vehicle insurance, are actually giving back money to clients because nobody's driving really at this point in time, or very little.
Yeah, that payback program is a goodwill program that people remember also. If your insurance company didn't give you money back,
you remember.
And everybody else, your neighbors did, there's a good chance you'll remember that when it's time to renew your insurance.
That's a very strong point, and I can, on a personal level, agree with you on that. I think a question that's come in here I don't know if you'll know the answer to this one, but I think it's an important one. This entrepreneur is looking for online resources where they could find maybe joint venture proposals for SMEs, a way to kind of survive this kind of crisis. So are there companies with whom they could kind of join forces potentially to kind of either come up with a better offering or access a different customer base to do some of the things that you talked about in terms of either, you know, repurposing, retooling, or redeploying? I'm not aware of one myself online, but I don't know if you've heard of anything where companies can kind of match with each other to try to join forces.
Okay, so I have not heard of one online, but I'm going to go back to the recommendation I made earlier, because this is where I've heard that, yep. Which is when I said to you that you should reach out to the owners and operators and managing directors of all the companies physically near you in your geography for now, and create an every Friday Zoom call. Because what I found out was in these calls, all these companies had a bunch of CEOs on the call. And one group that told me, and he called me back and he said, I just reached out to my competitors, to all the CEOs in my area. And we formed this every Friday Zoom group. And we started these conversations, and we've already formed two joint ventures of people that have never worked together. And in some cases were competitors. We found something none of us were big enough to do. It was orders to fill orders from government and other people. And none of them were big enough to do it, but they found out if the competitors all banded together in a joint venture, they could take that money and fill that order. And so I don't know of a place online, but I think you should start by reaching out, creating your own working group, and asking that question on the group. Hey guys, is there anything we could be doing together that we can't do alone? Seeing people find it. The answer is yes.
And if I can make a shameless plug, I mean, that's exactly what the seed peer groups are all about, right? That's the first place that you can go to get some advice or maybe find some other companies that you could connect with. That might be an opportunity for either a joint venture or working on a sale of a product or service together.
Peter, I'm actually going to add to your plug because, again, that's why I'm spending my time with you guys today, because I strongly believe in what seed does. So people that are in seed and not in a peer group should be. And if you're listening in and you're not in seed, you should consider joining it, because it is the resource that brings us all together so we can have those discussions. Again, that's why I'm here, because I think this is a great meeting point, connecting point for all of us. That's what SEED does.
Great. And I think in the interest of time, you know, I want to be respectful of the time that you've so graciously offered to us. We are coming kind of to the top of the hour. Do you think you can take maybe one more question here before we end?
Or yes, and before we do, I would say two quick things. Because I have not been able to read the chat as it's been going by, but Bree, there is a way that you can save the chat transcript and email it to me if you don't mind. So I'll look at it. And the reason I want to do that is why I'm going to say this last thing, which is it helps me to get feedback from you guys. If I'm giving advice that is useful, that's great. I'd like to know that. And if I'm leaving things out or I'm telling you things you don't believe in, someone should tell me that so I don't keep saying them. So I'm going to tell you my email is just jeff@jeffhoffman.com. And I'm happy to hear from you, questions I couldn't answer here, or just your feedback. Let me know if this was helpful or if I'm getting something wrong here, so that I can improve as well. So go ahead, let's go on to that last question.
Perfect. Well, I'd be happy to do that, Jeff. Thanks so much. This one's kind of like looking towards the future here. I know you've done that pretty well. You know, how will the world look? Or how do you think the world will look at the end of 2021? So as we kind of come through this crisis,
sure.
Just in a general sense, what do you think it'll look like?
I think two things, both good. One gooder than the other. The first one is we will be a more electronic world, which will improve efficiency. We will do more work at home. We will do more education at home. We will do more healthcare at home. And those are all wins for the human race. When you think of education, by the way, I think schools and universities are going to have to step up, or they're going to have to answer the question, why do I need to go to class every day? Kids are already saying that. What is school going to look like after this? So I don't think every school is going to require every student to be in class every day again. Some schools are going to modify and have a hybrid version, just as some companies are going to have a hybrid of working at home and working in the office. So I think the electronic world and it is going to change the face of how we do everything, of how we go to school and how we go to work. It's not going to be the same. It's going to be more efficient and more human to be able to spend more time not in the office and not at school. And I'm not saying that that's necessarily good. Schools will decide amongst themselves what things they can teach at home and what they can teach at school. But as you get older, like university level, those students I think more of them will take online education. I'm not talking about little kids. And I think the good is the moment we are experiencing right here, thanks to SEED. We are, again, we have never, I think I mentioned this at the beginning, but I want to close with this. The unique thing of this COVID pandemic is this is probably one of the first times ever that the whole human race is fighting the same enemy.
Yeah.
When in wars, we're all fighting different enemies, right? In smaller wars and conflicts, we're fighting different enemies. In economies, some of us countries are down while some are up, different enemies. This is the first time that the whole planet is fighting the same enemy. So by definition, like we're doing now, for the first time ever, we're coming together to help each other in a way we haven't before. And I think that because of these electronic tools, and before, you might not have met other SEED members if you didn't go to a physical SEED event. But now that there's SEED webinars, as an example, you'll be able to connect with and see and meet people online you didn't before. I think that we're going to become much better. Peter, you know that sometimes on my social media, I use the hashtag #OneHumanFamily.
That's right.
And I put #OneHumanFamily just to keep reminding people that, you know, we're all in this whole battle of life. We were all in this life together anyway. But COVID has served to remind us how much we all want the same thing. We want our family to be safe. We want to be able to pay our bills. We want to take care of our elderly. All these things, all human beings want the same thing. This pandemic is making that more clear. It's giving us more tools to connect, to cooperate, to joint venture, to share. And I think that on the backside of this, humanity comes out better because we are more of a global family than we've ever been before. And I'm actually excited about that. Silver lining is just unfortunate that we'll lose so many people along the way. And I hope the medical community fixes that. But I think the human race will come out stronger and more united after this.
Jeff, that was a great way to close. You know, again, thank you so much for your time. For all of you following us online, we will be sending out information to everyone who joined so you can get more resources on SEED. You can follow us at our website at seed-global.org, LinkedIn, SEED Global, or on Twitter at SEED Global as well. And again, we will be sending out emails to everyone who joined today so you get follow-up resources. We'll also connect with Jeff if he has a slide on the three R's to kind of remind everybody of what those key points. But again, Jeff, thank you so much for joining us today. Stay healthy, stay safe, and stay in touch.
Thank you.
Talk soon. Bye-bye.